Harvest and Harper Audio present Sleeping Bags to S'mores, Camping Basics, written and read by Heather Balogh Rochfort and William Rochfort.
For Liliana, always.
Chapter 1. Picking the Destination. Of the two of us, I am definitely the aggressive planner. At any given moment, I can tell you the locations and dates of the next 10 to 15 hiking trips we have planned, as well as the major international trips we'll take the next 4 years. In a way, I feel the same about planning trips as George R.R. Martin feels about writing. The good ones end up being epics, but I enjoy the state of having completed the task much more than the act of doing it.
As for me, I prefer surviving the day.
But I continue on with my type A planning personality because it is the sole act that has taken us on hundreds of hiking trips. And even though we're nearly halfway through our lifetimes and our bodies are nearly half dead, we intend to head out on hundreds more. If you're a first-timer, planning a trip into the wilderness can be intimidating. For clarity, you will make mistakes and you will do something like pack the wrong gear. We can talk later about that time I brought 3 extra-large sweatshirts and 4 gallons of water on my first backpacking trip, or that one adventure where Heather thought canned soup was the best way to cut her backpack size. Bottom line, the biggest mistake you can make is not to go. We're not advocating for lack of preparedness, but we are strongly endorsing the 40-70 rule. You need at least 40% of the available information to make a decision, and once you get beyond 70%, you should lean on intuition to fill in the gaps rather than postpone actually doing something. Mad thanks to Colin Powell for that life advice. Start by simply focusing on your destination selection. Decide on one of the trips outlined here, do a reasonable amount of research on your destination, find a friend and or unsuspecting significant other to join you, and then set the date to sleep on some dirt. If you really want to emotionally overcommit, make it Facebook official and tell everyone else who is scrolling their phone in some corporate meeting that you're going camping. Nothing says commitment like declaring intent on social media. We like to break hiking trips into 3 categories: day hikes, overnights, and dispersed camping. The distinctions among the 3 drive the destinations we are interested in, as well as our gear loadout. Ergo, depending on how much time you have and how many times you want to cry because of your heavy pack weight, you may lean towards one particular style more than another. Of course, many blur the lines among the 3. For example, most civilized humans treat Colorado's iconic 4-pass loop as a 4-day backpacking trip, but there are absurdly ambitious individuals who hike and run the 28 miles in a single day under the auspices of fun. You do you. Day hikes. This could be a low-key hike to a backcountry hot spring, or it could be a 20-mile Jake and Elwood mission from God. The punchline is that it is a hike you complete in a day, which means that finding a destination with a particular highlight will likely make the day more interesting. For our family, this usually means peak bagging the Colorado 14er, a summit with an elevation of at least 14,000 feet, although I've also made a day of tracking down champion trees in the Eastern Sierra, secret waterfalls in Montana, and the perfect whale-watching outcropping on the Channel Islands. The real perk here is the lightweight backpack. Unfettered by the trappings of overnight accommodations, your pack weight might be only around 10 pounds, making it much easier to cover unholy distances or scramble up a talus field. Or you can be a real mensch and secretly stash a 6-pack of summit beers. Even if you don't imbibe, you will be an instant legend when you deliver a life-changing libation after a grueling high-altitude climb. Whatever you carry, don't be a rube and skimp on the 10 essentials, which we reveal on page 32, because you want to save a few ounces. Even if you don't end up needing the gear, you could save someone else's tail on the trail. A further word on safety. Anecdotally, day hikers are the most likely to get stuck in an unintentionally undesirable situation. When you're backpacking, you have your entire world on your shoulders, and in most circumstances, you can safely pitch a tent if the weather takes a nasty turn. With a lightweight day pack, you are either going to have to construct a shelter out of the flimsy shell jacket and granola bar from the bottom of your pack, or optimistically hope Les Stroud is sharing your trail today. It can happen fast. On a day trip to the Angela Adams Wilderness several years back, one of our friends went for a quick hike in running shoes, a t-shirt, and the kind of shorts that reveal a blinding amount of upper man thigh. He was an experienced backcountry hiker as well as an accomplished marathoner. Yet 15 minutes after departing camp, he slipped while traversing the snowfield, and without an ice axe to arrest, he slid hundreds of feet down to the lake below. Although he left camp on a 75-degree midsummer day, temps were in the mid-40s when he limped the several miles back to camp 12 hours later. Aside from a gruesome ice rash, although we all agreed it was karma for wearing the short shorts, and moderately wounded pride, he was lucky to be no worse for wear. Overnights. There are entire tomes dedicated to the fine art of selecting overnight backpacking locations, so we shall not endeavor to condense them to a few hundred words here. However, we would offer some valuable lessons learned.
Start with attainable mileage goals.
If you get to camp sooner than expected, congrats! Go fishing, or enjoy your book or the unbridled company of friends who are temporarily released from the tyranny of their cellular devices. We are hashtag blessed to live in one of the most geographically gifted countries in the world. We've backpacked in Tasmania, Jordan, New Zealand, South Africa, Iceland, and others. And if we were told we could only hike in one country for the balance of our coexistence, we would choose the American West and never look back. Once you get a few local trips under your belt, pick an iconic American destination and book it. Also, take the time to dig deeper than the first page of Google results. Yes, everyone should visit the Canyonlands if they can, but have you ever heard of Red Break and Escalante National Monument? Or in addition to Yosemite's Half Dome, check out Second Lake in the Palisades. It is the best bang for buck overnight in existence, in our humble opinions. If the forecast looks sketchy, don't be afraid to bail. Every year, people perish thanks to lightning strikes, flash floods, and a host of other avoidable natural causes. Yes, it is extremely difficult to pull the plug on the Zion trip you've been planning for months, but that is significantly better than asking a loved one to make the decision on whether to pull your plug after a search and rescue scrapes you from the bottom of a slot canyon without a pulse. The summits will be here tomorrow. Make sure you are too. Dispersed camping. This is where we indulge. In our chronologically advanced state, we've developed a new appreciation for dispersed camping, which is a particular variety of car camping. Previously, I believed car camping meant you were stuffed into an organized campground with loud snorers, cranky generators, and a peculiar number of white windowless vans. But that is only for those unwilling to do a little homework.
Thankfully, I showed him the error of his ways.
Certain wilderness areas such as National Forest and BLM land, that's the Bureau of Land Management, allow dispersed camping at large or in designated sites, and it's usually free. One of our favorite spots is along the Laramie River in northern Colorado's Arapaho National Forest. We pulled up in late summer to a hazy, backlit campsite with our own private swimming hole and a decrepit, yet romantic, old cabin that had misplaced its roof years before. After rigging hammocks, we kicked up our feet and swayed in a breeze, reveling in our superior intelligence that had accidentally led us to this location. Or here is another one of our favorite plays. See if there's a national forest that abuts your favorite national park. For example, when visiting Bryce Canyon National Park, we stayed 30 minutes away in Dixie National Forest, where the camping is free, and we had a private creekside campsite to ourselves. Even though the paid campgrounds are booked in the park months in advance, we showed up in early summer and had no trouble finding the site. The added bonus, since we were camping with our 7-month-old daughter, we didn't have neighbors giving us salty looks the next morning because of her random bouts of wailing in the middle of the night. Take a look at the public lands near you, check the camping restrictions, and then simply pick a spot based on what looks good on the map. We've stumbled upon our favorite camping spots this way, many of which we return to year after year, and almost all of which never show up in a guidebook. And since you're car camping, you can have every reasonable amenity you could possibly ask for, and then some. Bring your favorite pillow from home, your queen-size air mattress, and your full-size camping chair. Treat yourself and pack a bottle of wine, too. Dispersed camping is an embarrassment of riches.
Chapter 2. Camping inside or out? Camping comes in a variety of different strokes for different folks. Although we largely consider ourselves time-tested backpackers, we take great satisfaction in staying outdoors in whatever shelter suits the circumstances. We have strong emotional attachments to backcountry cabins with wood-burning stoves in the winter. In midsummer, we are happy to leave the tent at home when we feel optimistic. The point is that there is not one right way to do it. Tent or no tent, The only thing you can do wrong is to marinate at home on the couch instead of getting out and putting some nature in front of yourself. Cowboy camping. We understand why someone may be reticent to sleep sand shelter. What about unexpected weather? Will I get cold? What about bugs and snakes? Urban legends tell us that most humans consume 8 spiders every year, and this usually happens while sleeping in beds inside cozy, warm, and properly sealed homes. We'd argue that if you're going to ingest an arachnid, you might as well get your money's worth and sleep under the stars. Assuming the weather cooperates, this is by far our favorite kind of camping. It brings back the romance of the American West, and it is easy to see the world in the same way as those who lived there hundreds of years before us. Not to mention, it affords you an extremely lightweight pack. Thanks to 3 ACL surgeries resulting in an octogenarian's knees, Will always hikes with trekking poles, which means we can drop a 5-ounce tarp in one of our packs and always be able to rig a crisis shelter if necessary. Otherwise, save the couple of pounds of weight and cram everything you need into an oversized day pack. Stripping your shelter will help you find other ways to cut unnecessary weight. You don't really need a fresh pair of socks for each day. You will cover more ground, see more wilderness, and genuflect on the fact that Sacagawea covered double-digit miles while pregnant and carrying at least triple what you have. If you really want to do it right, time it with a meteor shower like the Perseids in early August. Stargazing through tent mesh is like kissing your second cousin. Technically allowed, but probably not what you want to be doing. This is an annual celestial event, and if you've never seen a proper meteor shower, whatever shooting stars you've seen up to this point will feel like a cheap imitation. These meteors glow greens and purples and leave streaks across the sky when they burn through the atmosphere. It is the kind of event that will reconstitute your perspective on the universe. Tent camping. We'd surmise that this is what most people picture when they imagine going camping. Do not underestimate the romance of putting your entire life on your back for a weekend, or longer, heading into the backcountry, and creating a temporary home wherever you end up. Even though only a thin nylon wall separates you from the elements, once you get that tent pitched, sleeping mat inflated, sleeping bag lofted up, and have cozied up next to your tent mate, you will feel like you're tucked away safely in the Shire. Several years ago, we experienced an approaching army of cumulonimbus clouds while backpacking near Zapata Lake in Colorado's Sangre de Cristo Mountains. We barely had our Hubba Hubba tent pitched in the grove before the sky opened up. It started with hail before turning to heavy rain. The storm was so close it seemed the thunder preempted the lightning, and every clap rattled the granite walls as well as our internal organs. It was exhilarating, and we would do it again in a heartbeat. Camper vans. Neither of us will ever forget the first night of our honeymoon in Canada. No, not for that reason. Calm down. Thanks to our Volkswagen Eurovan's maxed out uphill speed of 55 miles per hour, it took us 2 days to drive from Denver to Alberta for 10 days of autumn camping along the Icefields Parkway. We pulled into the rainy Lake O'Hara trailhead in Yoho National Park just before sunset, popped the top, and turned on the thermostat. Will cooked dinner while I snuggled with our mutt in the back seat. Safely ensconced in our German incubator, we enjoyed 3 cheese ravioli, a side salad, and red wine while watching the snow lilt to the forest floor on the other side of the windshield. Cheesy, but true. Home was where we parked it. From that night forward, we've been strong advocates for camper van travel. As the previous story underscores, it is extremely satisfying to arrive at the trailhead in inclement weather and not futz with the tent poles. Additionally, while we have slept in a nylon tent in 15 below weather in Yellowstone, we both readily concede to the perks of waking up in a climate-controlled van in sub-freezing conditions. Camper vans also afford a degree of spontaneity that you don't get with hotels or traditional backcountry tent camping. When we traveled to Alberta, our plan was to simply look at the map each morning and decide which trail to go hike next, and it was one of the most relaxing hiking trips either of us has ever enjoyed. If we loved a trail, we would stay an extra night. If we arrived somewhere and it looked crowded, we'd keep right on going until we found the solitude we wanted. Additionally, camper vans are the perfect way to dip your toes into hiking in cold weather with your kids. We brought our 5-month-old baby girl on a camper van trip to Iceland in March, and she thought it was the greatest thing on planet Earth. Note, she didn't care about Iceland, but that van! We rented a larger van than our honeymoon iteration because it featured a lofted bed. This wasn't for our daughter. Rather, we needed a place to stash the ungodly amounts of baby luggage that slightly exceeded the combined weight of two adults' belongings. Will still can't justify why a tiny human necessitates that much stuff, but he only has 49% of the vote, so he finally quit trying. We drove around the Snæfellsnes Peninsula for nearly a week, and it immediately became apparent just how convenient a house on wheels is when traveling with an infant. When she needed to breastfeed, we pulled over by Kirkjufell Mountain and opened the sliding doors on either side, and I sat in the sunshine with a cross breeze and a multi-million-dollar view of one of Iceland's most famous landmarks. If she needed to nap, we'd find the nearest trailhead and take turns hiking and taking photos.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.